You were created to know and enjoy God. You were called to be in community so that you can become all that God desires you to be. God designed you with a purpose so you can be the difference in this world. And we exist to help you on that journey. Graceway.
Hey, what's up, Graceway family? My name is Pastor Brandon Smith, and this is my gorgeous wife, Tara.
Thank you for joining us online. We'll be back after the message to share next steps with you to help you deepen your faith.
Hey, the service is getting started, so come on, let's join in.
I got my festive shirt on for the series, and so we're feeling the warmth today, amen? We're feeling the warmth. I'm ready to go. Go ahead and open your Bibles if you got them, or turn on your devices by God's grace to 2 Peter 1, 1 through 15. Hey, we're gonna keep it real simple today, okay? Anybody like keeping it simple? We're gonna try to hit some layups today, and we're not trying to hit any half-court shots, okay? We're gonna keep it real simple. And we want to get you some things that are going to help you today. I feel like this past season has made some things that should be simple difficult. Amen? And so I want to make some things some real clear for us today. I just want to preach real simple today from this idea of you can change. Okay. You're not there yet, but you're going to get there, okay? Do I have any shouters in the room with me? There we go. Okay, if you can shout at a Chiefs game, you can shout for Jesus, amen? Okay, don't tell me I'm more of a reserve guy. No, you're not. We've seen you, okay? You got half your face painted red, half yellow, okay? You're not reserved. You're trying to be Braveheart at a football game, okay? You can get your shout on for Jesus today. So we're going to be in the book of 2 Peter today. And for just a little context before we dive in, Peter wrote these two letters to encourage Christians. And so he was writing to believing people. First Peter, he's writing to a people who are experiencing persecution, but it's a persecution that we can identify with because it's not physical persecution for their faith, but rather ridicule and isolation for their faith in Jesus. Y'all ever experienced that before? And so a lot of the times the persecution we see in the New Testament is hard for us to identify because it's physical. But here in 1 Peter, he writes to encourage people who are experiencing ridicule and isolation for their faith. And what he tells them in 1 Peter is to stand firm. Stand firm in your faith. And then he writes his sequel. Who here knows that sometimes the sequel can be just as good as the original, okay? And he writes his sequel in 2 Peter to encourage Christians, now that you have stood firm for a season, now his whole idea is to grow in your faith. You've stood firm. Now, what I think is this past year or so in the pandemic, we've worked a lot on trying to stand firm. It's been a lot of attacks coming up to the people of God, to our lives, and we've had to stand firm in this past season. But I think we're nearing the end of it by God's grace. We're seeing a silver lining to the end of this tunnel here, and now it's time not just to stand firm, but to take new ground. Amen? Anybody ready to grow instead of just standing firm? There we go. So let's look at God's word today and see what Peter would have to tell us about how we can change. 2 Peter verse 1 starting, or chapter 1 starting in verse 1 says this. Simeon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained a faith of equal standing with ours by the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. May grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sinful desire. For this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue, and virtue with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with steadfastness, and steadfastness with godliness, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective and unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For whoever lacks these qualities is so nearsighted that he is blind, having forgotten that he was cleansed from his former sins. Therefore, brothers, be all the more diligent to confirm your calling and election. For if you practice these qualities, you will never fall. For in this way, there will be richly provided for you an entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Get this. Therefore, I intend always to remind you of these qualities. Though you know them and are established in the truth that you have, I think it right, as long as I'm in this body, to stir you up by way of reminder, since I know that the putting off of my body will be soon, as our Lord Jesus Christ made clear to me. And I will make every effort so that after my departure, you may be able at any time to recall these things. May God add wisdom to the reading of his word. Today I want to preach from this idea, you can change. Turn to your neighbor, say, you can change. Now say back to him, I can change. There you go. I spent a little over a decade in the city of St. Louis, downtown in the inner city, and we always had an issue with squirrels. You got an issue with squirrels? I have personal beef with squirrels. They're just rats with fluffy tails. That's all it is, okay? They're not cute. They serve no purpose, okay? And in St. Louis, they would get up into your attic and they would chew through wires, all that kind of stuff. But the squirrels in the city had a little bit of an attitude, you know what I'm saying? Like, I would be taking my trash to the dumpster and there'd be a squirrel on the edge of the dumpster eating hot Cheetos, staring at me. And I would like try to stomp or flex at him to get him to go away. And he just flexed back and be like, what? This is my dumpster now. I live here, okay? This is mine. But then we moved here. We moved out of the city a little bit. We got some space and some trees back there. You know, this whole squirrel community is out in the backyard, okay? And the squirrels here, they still try to get in our attic, but they're a little, the squirrels here got more to lose. You know what I'm saying? Like, the squirrels here, I think they got a Roth IRA. They've been putting some acorns aside for, you know, retirement. They got baby squirrels at home. They're trying to get this family together, okay? They got a lot to lose, the squirrels here. And so when I open the door, they make a run for it. Like, they're not hanging out to see who I am, to make any introductions. And so I'm figuring, I'm like, how do I get these squirrels out of my attic? Because these ones, they're vigilant, okay? They're watching their backs at all time. And so I had to buy me this squirrel trap. It's a live trap, okay, if anybody is has a pet squirrel, okay? hipsters be walking squirrels on a leash downtown in Crossroads. So if you love squirrels, okay, it's a live trap. And so the way that you get the squirrel in the trap is you put a little bit of food, some corn, outside the first door, and then you put a whole bunch inside the trap. And so what the squirrel does is he comes up and he eats a little bit of the food, and he to where it's like a tease. And then he turns around, and this once vigilant squirrel who was very aware of his surroundings, his instincts have dulled now. And he walks inside the trap to this big pile of food and begins to gorge himself. And for the moment, it's amazing until he realizes he's stuck. And he can't get out of that trap until someone like me comes to relocate him to a squirrel retirement village somewhere out in the wilderness, far away from my home, till someone like me comes and liberates him by setting the door open and freeing him from the trap. If you journey with me, I think that many of us in this past season, trying to stand firm in our faith, have actually fallen into some traps, thinking that we were just surviving and eating some food that was good for us. We found ourselves in a place that we can't liberate ourselves from. And I want to walk with you today as we look to God's word to provide us understanding of how to get unstuck from what we're stuck in. Because you can change. Amen? I want to walk through four very simple things that you already have that can get you unstuck. Are you with me? You already got these, okay? You don't got to go to Lowe's. You already got these joints. You can get unstuck. You can change. The first thing we see in that Peter tells us is you already have that helps you change is you have a faith that changes things. You have a faith that changes things. See, some of y'all missed what Peter already said. Peter begins the text, his letter to us. These are his last words. He's going to die after this. He's going to be crucified upside down after this. He's going to die. And these are his final words to us. And he begins his final words to us by saying, hey, here's my name. I'm Simon Peter. I'm a servant. I'm an apostle of the Lord Jesus. And I'm writing to you all, you believers, who have a faith that is equal standing with ours. See, some of you missed your moment. Peter's saying, if you know Jesus, the faith that you have is equal to the faith of the apostles. That's crazy, because you don't think a lot about the faith you have. You think your faith can't do anything. And Peter says, no. If you know Jesus, you got a faith of equal standing with all the apostles. And that still didn't hit some of you because you don't know Peter's testimony. But I do. Let me tell you Peter's testimony. The first time that Peter met Jesus, he was working the third shift down at the docks. Y'all know that third shift life. It'll take 7 years off the end of your life. Real talk. Studies show, okay? Don't quote me. But that third shift life is tough. He fished all night long and didn't catch not one fish. And so they get in after the long day. He's thinking, man, let me go home, put my feet up, see what happened in the news cycle today. Just relax a little bit and then fall asleep. He cleans the nets. He folds them up. And then here comes Jesus. Hey, Simon Peter, I think you should put the boat back out and throw the nets back out. Now, I don't know about you, any third shifters in the room. I'm not trying to, my work is done. I didn't succeed today. But you don't know Peter's testimony. He turns to me and he says, we've been working all night, Jesus. But because you said so, we'll do it. They go back out. And with Jesus, they catch so much fish, the boats begin to sink. See, what you don't realize is that you have a because you said so faith. You have a faith like Peter's. If you gave your yes to Jesus, you said, listen, my life has been jacked up. I don't really see a way forward. But because you said so, teacher, I'll do it. You have a because you said so kind of faith. But some of y'all don't feel like that right now. But Peter has a bigger testimony than this, just the first time he met Jesus. You see, Peter also has a faith that struggled with doubt and fear. You see, when Jesus was being crucified, folks came to Peter and they said, hey, don't you know that guy? And he said, hey, I'm not the one. I don't want no smoke with what you got going on with the crosses and all this kind of business. I don't know the man. Even a little girl came to Peter and said, hey, weren't you with him? No, Nisi, gonna run off. I wasn't with this guy. You see, he had a faith that made room for doubt and fear even. Some of y'all know about that faith. But he had a faith that was bigger than that. He had a faith that returned. You see, when Jesus came to him after his resurrection and said, Peter, do you love me? He said, yes, Jesus. And Jesus asked Peter, do you love me, as many times as he had previously denied him. And every time Peter said, yes, of course I love you. Some of y'all need to realize you got a faith that allows you to return as well. You had the moment. You had the put the boat back out moment. But maybe you've been struggling with a faith that has room for doubt and fear. And you need to see, hey, Peter's saying, I've been there. You got a faith equal standing with mine. But that same faith allows you to return. But that's not all that his faith did. His faith also empowered him. That same Peter who locked himself in a room after Jesus had been killed, afraid of what they would do to him next, when he meets a resurrected Jesus, is empowered to go preach the gospel and begin the movement of the church. The faith that Peter had empowered him beyond what he could do physically. He had a because I told you so faith, a faith that allowed him room to doubt and fear, a faith that called him to return, and a faith that would empower him into the future. He had a faith that changes things, amen? And you can change because you have a faith that changes things. But he didn't just have faith that changes things. He also had, number two, the knowledge to change. Peter had all the knowledge he had to make the next change he needed in his life. Verse 3 says this, his divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence. Who here knows that knowing Jesus changes things? When you know him, things change. What changed? Your desires change. Your thoughts change. Your hopes change. Your dreams change. Your eternity changes. See, things change when you know Jesus, but you got to realize that knowledge is different than information. Knowing somebody is different than knowing things about somebody. Y'all got any of these friends that have an unhealthy relationship with celebrities? Like they talk to you about Beyonce like they just hung up the phone with her? Maybe you don't have a friend, so I'm going to expose myself a little bit. I'm going to be that friend for you right now, okay? I have a celebrity couple that I really believe are my friends, okay? Anybody here know Russell Wilson and Sierra? Okay, Russell Wilson is, there you go. You know him? Amen. We should have brunch sometime. So Russell Wilson is the quarterback of the Seattle Seahawks, and Sierra Wilson, I guess she has a last name. I just know her as Sierra. She must have more than one name. But she is a R&B singer, dancer, okay? So I know a lot about Russ and CeCe, okay? I grew up with Sierra. I was learning how to 1-2-step when she was telling me how to do it, okay? When Sierra told me to level up, I said, I'm ready to level up, CeCe. I want to level up with you, okay? I followed Russell Wilson's career when he was in college and watched him grow and decide baseball or football. What do I do? It's such a tough challenge. Pro baseball, pro football. Anyway, we all have different crosses to bear. And he decided to be an NFL player. I watched him. I watched Sierra get into some rough relationships. And then I saw her connect with Russell. And I'm like, man, they love the Lord. Like they pray together. They're open about their faith. This is an encouragement. Look at my friends, you know? And I'm going to break something to you and to myself. I don't know them. I've never met them in my life. I know their Instagram handles. I know all that kind of stuff. But I do know my wife. I know that she loves bubble tea. You know, the drink that you can chew. Amen. I know that she saves her bread to eat to the end of her meal because she thinks bread's dessert. You know? I know that she slurps her drink. If there's a drink to be drank, she will slurp it. Okay? We talked about this. I can go in, okay? I'm okay for this. I know that she hates it if I leave the house and we're in the middle of a fight. Like, I'm coming home to a whole different fight than I left, right? You see, I just don't know information about her. I have a relationship with her. When we know Jesus, that knowledge changes us because it means we have a relationship with Jesus. We've experienced the person of Jesus, not just information about him. If you're walking in something that you know Jesus isn't cool with, you feel that because you've experienced a relationship with him. And Peter's telling us that knowing Jesus means you already have what you need to change. It says that you have all you need for life and godliness. See, some of y'all think that your knowledge and relationship with Jesus is great for godliness. You're like, man, I love me some Jesus on Sunday. I love me some Jesus at small group. So you think your knowledge of Jesus is great for godliness, but Peter says it's good for your life too. Not just for godliness, but for real life. There are things in your life right now that need to change. Like, you aren't cool the way you are. And if you think you are, just ask anybody that knows you. And they'll tell you your life needs some adjustment. And Peter says the knowledge of Jesus actually gives you all you need to change in life too. You have all you need. But maybe the issue is you grew up with Jesus like I grew up with Sierra. Hello? Maybe while I was learning to 1-2-step, you were learning waves of mercy, waves of grace, right? You know the moves. You sang the songs. You got the information. You follow the Twitter handle, but you don't know him. And I'm telling you today, you can know him right now. He's not far off in Seattle or whatever house the Wilsons are in. He's in this house right now. And you can know him. You can say that. You can say, Jesus, I'm a sinner, and I need you to save me. I can't fix myself, but you can. I can't change myself, but I just heard that if I know you, I can change. Would you come into my life and change me? And if you invite him in, guess what he does? He enters. And you can know him. And by knowing him today means you have been given all the knowledge you need to change. Because you have a faith that changes things, and you have a knowledge of what to change. But it doesn't just stop there. He also tells us that you have the spirit of change. Verse 4, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that's in the world because of sinful desire. When you know Jesus, you get his promises. And what he's promised to you is the presence of his Holy Spirit. You see, in the Old Testament, the evidence of the Holy Spirit was usually a column of fire or a column of smoke. That's how you saw where the Holy Spirit was moving. And so you would follow that smoke or that fire. But something amazing happened actually to Peter, who's writing us this letter right now. When he was in the upper room waiting for the promise of the Holy Spirit, it says that something like flames of fire fell on the heads of all the apostles. Now, don't get freaked out about this. It's a symbol from the Old Testament to the New. Back in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit was here, but now the Holy Spirit is here. So we don't look to a column of fire to follow where God is leading. We get to ask the Spirit in us, God, would you do something different in me? I need the power and presence of your Holy Spirit. And the thing is, if you know Jesus, you got the spirit of change in you. Philippians 2 and 13 says it like this, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. You can change because God has given you his change agent to help you. You don't have to work really hard to be better. You can ask God to help you change, and he does it. But some of y'all are real smart and educated, got more degrees than Fahrenheit. Y'all are real sadiddy, and you're like, hey, listen, all this faith and all this spirit, that's all great. All this relationship, that's cool. But how, though? How? Well, good thing Peter's smarter than all of us, because he tells us. He tells us you don't just have the faith that changes things or the knowledge to change or the spirit of change in you. He says you know the process to change. He says you know it. Verse 5 says this. For this very reason, the reason being you have faith and knowledge and the Spirit. For that reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue, and virtue with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with steadfastness, godliness, brotherly affection, and love. What he's telling you, he says in the very first few words, change is going to take effort. See, some of y'all want change but don't want to put forth effort. You want something different to happen, but don't want to do anything different. You see, we're told, I'm just going to wait on the Lord. I'm going to wait on the Lord right now, right? Well, the scriptures actually tell us how to wait on the Lord. The scriptures tell us to have patience like the farmer. Now, I've lived in the city for the past few years, but I grew up in the sticks. Any hillbillies in the place, amen? Okay, I used to, some of y'all think a combine is only in the NFL, okay? A combine actually brings in corn. I used to ride on a combine with our neighbor who owned the farmland. And the Bible tells us to have patience like a farmer. Well, the farmer I knew was the hardest working dude I'd ever met in my whole life. Before he planted the seed, he would till the soil. And then he would put different fertilizer in the soil before he ever planted. Then he'd plant the seed. Then they'd weed and work and do all the things. Now, what he couldn't control was the sunshine. He couldn't control that. What he couldn't control was when the rain fell. He couldn't control that. But he could work in the waiting, putting forth some effort, hoping that God would produce a fruit. And what you need to hear today is you can change, but you got to make some effort. You got to put some effort forth, because your effort on top of the things you already have, faith, knowledge, and spirit, is the process that produces change in your life. But he says, take every effort to supplement your faith. You see, change takes supplements. You see, we got some lifters here in the room. Y'all know about supplements, right? You got to put some supplements. And it's supplement season right now. I don't know if you knew this, but it's supplement season. My wife, every night after dinner, will put 3 pills in front of me. And she'll say, here, take these. And just pray for us, because I have no idea what those pills are. She says it's some vitamins and minerals. I'm like, okay, Lord, this is the woman you gave me. So I'm going to take the pills she gives me. So I don't, you know, if my life insurance policy goes up, we'll just know who to look at. Change. But see, my immune system right now, while I have it and it's amazing, needs a little supplement to get me through this season. And you need to realize that God has given you faith, knowledge, and his spirit. And he's saying to you, hey, now supplement these things with a little virtue. Supplement these things with a little steadfastness. How about a little brotherly affection? How about some love? Just be a blessing to somebody for no reason except to bless them. How about we supplement our faith with these things? And he says, if you are increasing in these qualities, you will not fall. But we're lazy. And laziness, Peter says, makes us forget. Verse 9. For whoever lacks these qualities is so nearsighted that he is blind, having forgotten that he was cleansed from his former sins. Before I get into our laziness, I want to wrap up with 3 practical P's that you need if you want to change. You see, you have all these things that you need, and you're called to supplement your faith for change. But sometimes knowing Jesus means we have some knowledge about ourselves, that we need some help with our change. And he gives us some things. One, he gives us prayer. If there's something in your life you need change in, you need to pray about it. If I know Jesus, I know I should pray. Secondly, you need some people. You need people in your life who will point you to change, who will help you and give accountability to you to change. And thirdly, you may need some professionals. Hello? A lot of Jesus and a little therapy. There's some work in my house that I don't do. I don't mess with plumbing or electrical. I don't have the knowledge or the tools to mess with that. So I call somebody who has the knowledge and the tools to help me with those systems. You may have some situations in your life that are heavier than pastoral counsel can help you. You may have some deep-seated trauma in your life that you can't just pray away. You may need some professionals every once in a while. Amen? But laziness makes us forget. When we lack these qualities, this virtue, this steadfastness, this brotherly affection and love, we forget that we've already been changed. We forget that we can change because when we stop putting effort and supplementing our faith, we forgot that Jesus has already changed us from death to life. When you forget that you've been changed, you forget that you can change because you've gotten lazy in your faith. You need to put effort for it and remember that Jesus has taken you from a mighty long way and he hadn't brought you this far to leave you. He's saying, hey, I want to do something for you. See, laziness is making you forget. This past season was a season where we just sat around a lot, right? Binged a lot of shows. Y'all been through the beginning and the end of Netflix, okay? We watched the whole thing. Now people are like, we got to create new subscription systems because we're done with those ones. So we've gotten lazy and we've forgotten that we have everything we need to become different people. We don't got to stay stuck anymore. And what Peter says is, you need a reminder. You need a reminder. A reminder that you've been changed and that you can become a different person. I want to tell you this and then I'm in my seat. I'm through. I just want to tell you this little story. So for the past decade or so, we've been a church planting in St. Louis. And as a church planter, I raise 100% of my salary. So every dollar that I would make as a church planter, I would have to have lunches and dinners and send emails and people like avoiding, like I'm a bill collector, like people avoiding my phone call. And I have to raise money to support the ministry we were doing. And we were satisfied in that because God had called us to that season. But we, I'll just be real honest, we financially struggled for our whole marriage. And so God gave me something in our struggle to help us. You ever been in a season of struggle and God gave you something to help you survive? And he gave me a side hustle. Amen. Anybody got a side hustle testimony in the room? Okay. He gave me a side hustle. And I began to identify things that I could buy for a little bit and flip for a lot. And so I began to just become a picker and start flipping stuff. But before long, the thing that God provided me to bring security to my family actually produced an anxiety in me. Like, what if I stop being able to find stuff, though? What if it runs out? And then what do I do? And what God had done, all of a sudden, I put on myself. And this provision of God became an anxiety for me. And then God brought about a new season in our life. He called us to Kansas City. And he brings us to Kansas City. And for the first time in our marriage, like, we had some financial breathing room. And there was some relief that came in. But you know what? You know what the enemy does? The enemy will bring you into a new season with old hangups. And so I stepped into this new life that God had provided. You know what I found myself doing? I'd leave work and I'd go to thrift stores. And I'd look for some stuff. Oh, this is worth this. And then I filled my garage up with junk and my wife got angry, right? So the only solution to that is to get a storage unit. That's the only, I prayed about it. God said, increase your land. I was like, okay, get a storage unit. And so I moved into a storage unit. And then I got me an antique booth and started selling some of it. And my wife finally got the boldness one night to sit me down and she said, why are you still doing this? And I had the audacity to say, it's fun though. I'm having fun. I wasn't having fun. See, some of y'all are in a trap. You can't see a way out, and so you convince yourself, I like the trap. This is good for me. I'm having fun in here. And my wife said, you don't have to do this anymore. You see, I had forgotten. I had forgotten that God was doing something different in my life. And that God was calling me to enter into a different season, not just of life, but personally. That before I was a church planter, a husband, a pastor, I was a son of God. And the work that he was doing in me was more important than the work he was doing through me. And so I needed to chill out and stop being stuck. And Peter says three times in his dying words, I'm gonna give my last breath to remind you. And so let me be Peter to you today. You can change. You don't have to stay stuck in whatever situation you are in. You can be different. And guess what? You got all you need to change. If you know Jesus, you already have everything you need. You got a faith that changes things. You got a knowledge to change. You got the spirit of change living in you. And for you functional types, you got a process to change. But you got lazy. And so let me be your reminder today. Amen. You don't have to do it anymore. What you're holding on to, baby, you can stop. You can let that past situation go and step into whatever new thing God is doing in your life. By the power and the presence of Jesus, you can change. Let's pray. God, we thank you. I just want to say, Lord, thank you for changing me. I'm not who I was because of Jesus. And by your grace, God, I'll become something different in the future because of Jesus. So would you help us today, God? If we feel stuck right now, maybe, God, you're bringing things up to our minds right now that we wish we could change. Things in our lives that we're tired of doing the same old thing. God, would you give us a faith today that would change that situation? Would you reveal knowledge to us that we need to change? God, would you enact the spirit in our lives to change us? God, help us to put effort forth today to walk through the process of change. And God, where we have gotten lazy, would you remind us by the power of your Holy Spirit today? God, as we sing these next few words of praise, God, I pray these words of praise on our lips would inspire the change that needs to happen in us. God, we can change, and it's by your power that we do it. Help us, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Come on, church, let's give God a hand clap of praise for that message. Would you go ahead and stand to your feet and sing this last song with us?
Now, but I just want to thank the worship team. They always just lead us into the presence of the Lord. Man, it takes a certain integrity and a certain purity to be able to lead people like that. So I just wanted to say thank you and honor you guys. But anyway, friends, on June 20th, we are celebrating Father's Day, which is fantastic. And so we are going to have a special Father's Day message. And then we're also going to have a car show that's going to take place in the parking lot afterwards. And so there's these cool things, little coasters. And what I want you to do is I want you to invite men in your life, whether it's your neighbor, your friend, your uncle. One of the things that I've noticed is that things are always better when you invite a buddy, when you have a friend with you. And so if there's someone you know, there's some desks that you will be able to grab one of these, and it'll be great to invite them. So I think we're going to check out a little video.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
If you're new or looking for a way to deepen your faith or even know more about us as a church here at Graceway, I invite you to join us for Growth Track On Demand. The link is on the screen.
Or if you're looking for an opportunity to join a Graceway small group, I want to encourage you to follow that same link that is now on the screen as well. We believe that you can grow by yourself with the Lord, but with the community of believers, the sky is the limits to how much you can grow with Christ. So get involved today by looking for a small group that would be fitting for you. Also, we want to thank you so much for your generous and kind hearts in giving to Graceway. It's because of those hearts that we're able to do many of the life-changing events that you see take place around Graceway. If you would like to give today, then you can also follow the link that is on the screen.
If you would like to connect or pray with a pastor, you can call or text 816-423-2877.
Speaking about prayer, let's pray right now. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity that we have to just fellowship with one another, God, and worship together and also hear a word from you. God, we just pray, God, that the words that were spoken today, God, would be full of life and full of spirit, and they would apply to our lives, and we can live them out in every day that we are here, Father. So we thank you, God, for the words. God, we pray that we would apply them to who we are, God, and that you would just continue to live in and through us as well. God, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy, and we give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen, and thank God.
Make sure to like and share this message. We'll see you next week.